So yes, so this session we will have your presentations, like 5-minute presentations, and like after that we will have a question and answer. So who is going to be the first one to present? Do we have any volunteer? Okay, Ms. Dr. Sami, please go ahead. Let me assign you as presenter. So you're now presenter. Please go ahead and you have the option if you go to quick start on the very top, and then you have something called share file. If you press on that tab, then like at the side, there's an arrow. If you press on that arrow, then you share a file, then you can find it on your computer and then upload it onto here, your slides.
Yes, thank you so much, Mr. Kuyan. I'm trying to do so. Share my desktop.
Instead of sharing desktop, you can choose the second one, which is share a file, and then choose that specific file, like, and then upload it here. So that might be easier.
Now, do you see my slides, please?
No, we don't.
Sorry. I'm sharing.
You know, yes, now I see. Now I see it, yes.
Okay. Yes. My dear friends, if you can see my slides, please let me know.
Yes.
Then I can start.
Yes, please go ahead and start.
Okay, yes.
You're on the last slide, which is your thank you page.
Now I have the first slide. I introduce you the international business strategy. Actually, following your instruction, I had a surf on the net, and I see I can give a lecture to you because all of you are so professional, especially you, that I decided to have maybe an example. And getting more familiar with the business strategy and the changing of a business strategy in the international business strategy. I give you an example of how changing a business strategy can improve organization performance.
Sorry, Dr. Sani, you're on page 6 now. I see your thank you page.
Yes.
I don't see your first page,
on the first page, maybe.
Now it's working, yes.
Okay, yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Thank you, please go on.
Yes, I think the speed of the internet, maybe. Okay, I'll give you an example. So I have just a few minutes. I decided to make it clear for me and also for other colleagues. I go to the next. Okay, the example that I choose for you is about the Yamaha. Nano company. Yamaha is one of the oldest and biggest company for musical instrument, as you know. And in the last decades, for the motorcycle that all of you maybe know. The new kind of piano that Yamaha give to the market has a very success in the market. actually the problem of Yamaha piano was started when the overall demand declined 10% a year. There is no voice. Sorry. I changed my place. How it works. You have my voice, please? Okay. Okay, the internet problem. Yes, the overall demand started declining 10% a year. Then decision makers of this company would face two choices. They could continue the same game. It means they could continue the same strategy that they had before. It means fight harder and being more effectively. They try this one a few years, and they try to be more effective. But the new game for the company was having the fresh eye for opportunities. It means they like to have some innovations, and they like to maybe change their strategy to see how it happened and how they get the bigger part of the market. Following this changing of the business strategy, they actually made a superb acoustic piano that was a combination of digital and optical technology. After that, they produced 14 million piano. They refitting the piano with PC and disc. There was very new things in the market that was done for the first time on the piano. Then they have also the additional digital value creating possibilities to the piano, and it was a kind of a very big innovation in this in this industry, in this piano industry. When they continue the same game, when they follow the same old strategy, old business strategy, actually they should do some delayering. They should change some arrangement. They should change some arrangement. I mean by the employee, by the production line, or something like this. And they have some divestment. They deteriorating performance. I mean, their performance is not going better after divestment. Their performance getting worse and worse. It means weaker. Then after they see that they have no success in the same game, they decided to start a new game. They started to change their strategy. They did a strategy, and they decided to have a new strategy recipe. After changing the new strategy, they got new vision and capabilities. They changed their vision and capabilities, and also they improving their performance by this new vision. If you go from up to down, you see that improving performance coming from the new vision and capabilities, and coming from the new strategic recipe. Then they find some progress, some development in their new production and in their new having the new share of the market. It is important that they got a lesson from this new game and the same game that I had before. And they make such a comparison for this one. We knew in the same game that they had before, the old strategy that they had before, they identify market segments they have done before. They're positioning themselves in a segment, and they serve more effectively in this market. They had nothing new, but they just hardly working, and they just make them better and more effective. But in the new business strategy that they started, they find the new strategic innovations. I mean the new piano, and they make the new instrument and new piano. And they were the first mover they have the first mover advantage. It means as we learn in the business strategy that everybody that come first to the market have some advantages of being the first one, being very unique, then about the price is upon them, and they have some advantages. And also avoidance head-to-head competition, because there were no competitors in the market. They were unique, and there is no need to compete with the other guys. About the strategic intent in the oldest strategy, in the business strategy, their strategic intent was out-competing with the rivals. And they had the similar strategic approach that they had before. They do the same thing, but of course better. But in the new games, in the new business strategy, their strategic intent was investing in new strategic recipes. That means the new innovation, and when they make the new piano, they invest on the new strategic piano, new strategic recipe, sorry. And they had the innovations on creating such things, and they got a new vision. And what was the outcome? The potential outcome of the old strategy was parity at the best. They were balanced, you know. Nothing happened, and there was some harmony in the system. Nothing changed, and there was the balance. And their strategy at the old system was incremental approach. But when you compare with the potential outcome of the new games, was the potential outcome was competitive superiority. They were the best, they were superior, and they compete at the very high level. And the distinct advantages they have, because as we told before, they were unique. And their approach in this system was fundamental. Their approach was very basic, very original. Then when you compare actually the same strategy with the new strategy, when you come through the changing this business strategy in this system, in this industry, you can see the by this comparison that they had more development, they had a very very big progress in the market, and they could sell very well this new product, and their new strategy actually worked very well. I think my time is very limited. Then I make it short, and thank you so much for your attention and for your time. Thank you so much, Mr. Kuya.
Hey, thank you very much. That was a great presentation. So let's open for question and answer. And if you don't mind, I'm going to ask you the first question. So on the same game and the new game, how do you think like this strategy is going to help with the demand? You mentioned they had a 10% decline in the demand. Then how do you think this strategy has improved the demand? Do you have any?
Actually, can I answer, please?
Yes, please, please.
Yes, I go back to the slide, Mr. Fiona, about the overall decline. I think, in my opinion, there was some problem in their business strategy that if they actually confront with this 10% decline per year, it is a big thing, big issue. 10% is not a small thing, actually. Then with the same game, if they fight harder and if they try to be more effectively even, they couldn't come over this 10% decline. Then the only thing that they think that they find out is the changing the way, changing their strategy, changing their vision and the way of thinking actually. after they change this new to the new game, and they as I told you before, they have a fresh eye for the quality, see that they can change something, then they can produce something new. They could cover this 10% or even get better and better in the world. That the acoustic piano, even nowadays after a year, is the best one in the world, and they can be more successful than before.
Okay, thank you. So, does anybody else have any questions, any comments or questions? Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Sami. I appreciate it.
You're welcome. Thank you so much for the time and your attention. Thank you very much.
Absolutely. Thank you. Okay, so who's going to be the next presenter? Okay, Mr. Nursen. Let me change you to...
Is my voice clear? Hello?
I can hear you. Hello? Yes, I can hear you.
Okay. By the permission of our teacher and respected classmates, first I would like to thank you that you have given us the opportunity to elaborate ourselves. Due to our short period, we cannot. I have just made one slide, as our teacher said last week that you can make only one slide or more than one slide. So we have 5 minutes. So in 5 minutes, we can only explain briefly. My topic today is that components of internal analysis. As we know that as we are studying business strategy, one of the important factors while making your strategy is to analyze your external and internal environment. As we know that we have two types of environment, internal and external. Externals are two, external environment is that environment that it affects our business directly. It's not in our control, like government policies, rule and regulations. These types of factors can affect our strategy or our business directly. But my topic today is components of internal analysis, how we use our internal strengths in order to make a good business strategy. Next slide. Yes. We have components of internal analysis. We have this, you can see this chart there is resources, capabilities, core competencies, discovering core competencies, competitive advantage, and strategic competitive advantage. Resources. Resources are basically the assets or the capability of a company. And we have two types of assets. One is tangible and the other is intangible. Through resources, we can achieve our main objective. That can be anything. And we have to, as I said, that we have two types of resources. One is tangible and intangible. Intangible resources, we have financial, physical, organizational, technological. These are the resources that can be tangible, that we can measure them. For example, in financial resources or those resources, it shows that the borrowing capacity of a company, or it also shows that how a company generates funds for himself internally. In physical the physical resources are those resources that it shows the location of the location, the plants, the machinery, the equipment, the equipment of a country, of a business. Organizational is it shows the structure, the reporting system of an organization, and the technological resources is those resources like trademarks, patents, copyrights. These are the technological resources. As for intangible resources, are those resources that that we cannot measure them. For example, like innovation, skills, knowledge. These are the resources, intangible resources of our company. And for capabilities. Capability and resources are like linked with each other. Capabilities, we integrate our resources in order to achieve our goal. And capability is also known as a general competency. Competency as a general competency, and core competency is also known as unique competency. And why I say that it is general competency, because every organization has human resource like employees, they have skills. But in core competency, that competitive edge of a company that other company doesn't have, they don't possess. For example, I will give a short example of Supreme Logistic Company. It's a multinational logistic company, so they only deal in NATO contracts. So this is their core competencies and capabilities. They have the skills, human resource, everything. For discovering core competency, we have to take in mind 2 points. One is sustainable advantage. The other is value chain analysis. In sustainable advantage, we have to see valuable capabilities, rare capabilities, costly to limit capabilities, non-substitute capabilities. And valuable capabilities, it helps a firm to neutralize threats or exploit opportunities. And their capability, it shows that those capabilities that only your company possess, and no other company than your competitor. For example, Apple company is only their only capability is that they only produce unique phones. So they are this is their real capability. And costly to limit capability are those capability that it shows your communication, your relationship between your customer, your management staff, your employees, and your suppliers. And non-substitute capabilities are basically firm's specific knowledge and organization culture. And the other very important factor in discovering core competency is value chain analysis. In value chain analysis, it shows those parts of operation that creates value and for the organization. And it can be achieved through lower cost or producing products with greater value. Through this you can achieve value chain value for your organization. But the main important in value chain is outsourcing. Outsourcing is basically when you purchase. Other operations from external companies, for example, I give an example of a Supreme Logistic Company. I will come to your questions later, Mr. Muhammad. Outsourcing, for example, Supreme Logistic Company is a multinational company, and they take NATO contracts but they don't provide logistic service by themselves. They hire other subcontracts within from Afghanistan. So through this, they are outsourcing, they are utilizing their resources. So through this, they can achieve their main goal. And competitive advantage, we know that competitive advantage is that you need is an edge that you have and your rivals or your competitors don't have. And the other factors of the other component of your internal analysis is a strategic competitive advantage. So how you can strategize your competitive advantage in order to achieve your main goal or your objectives very well. So you can be very you can strategize in order to be low cost in the market, or you can have a strategy to only focus on one main product, or you can have a strategy to produce different products for different customers. So in order to have a good internal analysis, we have to consider all these factors. So this was my topic. Due to our shortage of time, we cannot go in detail. So if anyone has a question, you can ask me.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Nuristani, for the good presentation. Let me start with the first question. So how do you think this chart would apply to your own career? Can you give us an example on how this chart, that internal analysis, can help give an example maybe from your own workplace or some
workplace? Yes, sir, I can give you an example. I'm working in an independent admission reform commission. So our core competency and our commission is to give policies to other government sectors and to control them and to evaluate them. So this is our main advantage that other government agencies they don't possess, because we control them, we give them policy, and they have to apply those policies. So these are this is one of our competitive edge in regard to other ministries, and we have resources, we have capabilities. So this is one of our core competency, and as this internal analysis, we can apply this my career, but I can not explain it because we don't have much time. So that's why I just gave an example of our organization's core competency.
Thank you very much. That was very good. So does anyone have any questions? Any questions? Okay. Okay, very good. Thank you, Mr.
Thank you, sir, for giving me the opportunity to present myself. As one of my classmates asked me that why I did not prepare a presentation regarding to my field, I would like to say that internal analysis is a general topic. It can be used, it can be utilized in any organization, in any form of business. So in order to do that, we have to study and we have to understand internal analysis. It's our own interpretation that how can we develop this analysis in our own business or in our own field. And secondly, I would like to say that last week you have told us that you can choose any topic. So this was a little bit interesting for me. That's why I choose this topic. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. So who is going to be the next volunteer? Okay, Mr. Salman. Okay.
Do you hear me, sir?
Yes, I can hear you. If you go to the very top, to the quick start, then click on share file on the very right hand side. You will see an arrow. If you press on that, you can either share your desktop or share a file and then browse it from your computer. Okay, you got it. Perfect.
Now you can hear, now you can see, sir?
Yes, I can hear and also see your slides. Outsourcing, very good. Please go ahead.
Okay, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, by the name of Allah and by permission of our respectful teacher and my dear classmate. Today I selected the topic of outsourcing as our assignment, and I want to present very shortly because of the shortage of time. And if there was something missing, please forgive me. Outsourcing. At first, we should have what is outsourcing. Definition of outsourcing. Outsourcing is a practice used by different companies to reduce costs by transferring portions of work to outside supplier rather than completing it internally. It means that sometimes it's necessary or it's needed for some companies to proceed with some of their works or to hand over or contract some of their work with some third party or some external supplier, that those work should be done by a third party. This is called outsourcing. Also, outsourcing is an allocation of specific business process to a specialist external service provider. It means also like that. Outsourcing is an effective cost-saving strategy when used properly. It is sometimes more affordable to purchase a quote from companies with competitive advantages than it is to produce the quote internally. For example, Dell company Dell company is producing or manufacturing computers, and sometimes it purchases some of the component or some equipment of the computers from another companies. Outsourcing is to contract out an internal business process to a third party rather than staffing it internally. The practice of contracting a business process out to a third party rather than staffing it internally is a common and modern economy. The term outsourcing became popular in the United States near the turn of 21st century. It means that the outsourcing is a very old issue, but nowadays, and it was became more popular in the United States since of 21st century. Outsourcing can include both foreign and domestic contracting, and sometimes includes offshoring. Offshoring, which means relocation of business function to another country. Financial savings from lower international labor rates. It is a big motivation for outsourcing or offshoring. It means that sometimes some companies relocate some of their business from one country to another country. And this is a very some benefitful for those companies. For example, maybe they save some of their money and use the labor from those country which cost lower than their own countries. Then what is the reason for outsourcing? It means that why some companies using outsourcing. Companies outsource to avoid certain types of costs and also avoid of burdensome regulation, avoid high taxes. For example, maybe in United States the taxes will be very higher than the, some other Asian country like India, Pakistan, and etc. Therefore, some companies relocate their businesses from U.S. or from European countries to some Asian countries, and they benefit from the lower taxes or for lower labor costs there in these countries. Avoid high energy costs and unreasonable costs that may be associated with defined benefit and labor union contracts and taxes for government mandate benefits. Perceived or actual gross margin and short-term incentivize a company to resource to outsource with reduced short-term costs. Executive management sees the opportunity for short-term profits while the income growth of the consumer base is strained. Lower labor costs and other regions motivate companies to outsource. Companies will not spend money for training new hires staff internally. For example, sometimes some companies outsource their some of their activities to some other companies. Yeah, and this time they do not need to hire new persons and new staff for their those works and this stuff. When they hire new, they will need some trainings, and they should until they should be familiar with the rule and regulation of companies, and this will take more time and will need more expenses. Therefore, companies prefer to outsource some of their activities. Lower regulatory costs in other areas are in addition to companies saving money when outsourcing. These are all the reasons that some companies doing outsourcing. What can be the advantage of the outsourcing? If outsourcing done for the right reasons, it will help the company grow and save money. There are some other advantages of outsourcing that go beyond the money. Here are some top 7 advantages of the outsourcing. One is get access to scale expertise. It means that sometimes when companies using outsourcing, it means do some contract with third party or another company, and this will give some accessibility to the expertise or skills of the third party. Focus on core activities, better risk management, increasing in-house efficiency, run your business 24 hours and 7 days. It means that sometimes, for example, when in the United States during the day, there is a day in the United States and there will be the night in India or in Pakistan or in Afghanistan, when some companies relocate some of their activities from US to India, and therefore when there is night in US, there will be a day in the India, and therefore their company will work here in India when there is night in the U.S. Therefore, this says there will be running of business will be 24 hours. Staffing flexibility is another advantage. Improve service and delight the customer. Cut cost and save day. Give the outsourcing will give your business a competitive edge. And also see an overall increase and the business. And also, beside of the advantages, there will be some disadvantages of outsourcing. A risk of exposing confidential area. It means that sometimes when a company do use outsourcing and outsource some of their activities to a third party or to a contract, and they will expose, or some of their confidential data will be exposed to the third party, and this is also is a risk for the company, and this can be a disadvantage. And also synchronizing the deliverables, hiding costs, and lack of customer focus. These are maybe some more disadvantages of outsourcing, but just I listed these few here. Example of outsourcing, maybe there are lots of companies using outsourcing, but I put here just two examples. One is the Sprint company. Sprint companies using telecom provider companies. One of the telecommunication component companies providing component is networking. Sprint outsource their networking process to a third party, which is Ericsson. The reason is that it will reduce capital requirement, it will simplify management, and also it will allow management to focus more time on the critical factor to grow the business. These are the benefits of outsourcing for Sprint to use outsourcing. And also another example is the Dell company, which is for manufacturing and computers. It also prefers sometimes to buy or purchase some of the components of the computer from third party. It means they also use outsourcing. Thank you very much for your attention, for your giving me the time. If there is any question, I'm in your service.
Thank you very much, Mr. Samet, for your presentation. Let's see if anybody has any questions. Any questions from anyone? Okay, so
you're welcome.
Thank you. Just let me ask you a question, since someone has a question. So I want to ask you, why do you think certain countries are normally used for outsourcing when it comes to exporting to other countries? And also, when it comes to outsourcing to other companies, what do you think is the main decision basis when a company wants to outsource? Is it just the cost, or what should they look at? Can they outsource anything they want, or there are only certain jobs that they can outsource?
I think they will outsource some certain jobs, which sometimes they which is actually they will focus more on their core activities, but sometimes some process also can be easily done for by third parties, and they can outsource those activities. For example, and also the reason is that they will see for the cost effectiveness of those activities, and also for saving the time and saving the resources, and also for saving the customers, or for maintaining the customers. Therefore, sometimes some companies have to or prefer to outsource some companies in order to save the money or save the cost and make lower the cost, and also to speed up their process in order to fulfill the need of their customers.
Okay, thank you so much, Mr. Salman. Appreciate it.
Uh-huh. You're welcome, sir.
Okay, who's going to be the next presenter? Okay. Who's going next, please? Okay, Mr. Bafari. That's great. Please go ahead. You can go ahead on the quick start. Press on the arrow beside share file and either share your desktop or then or also browse the file from your computer.
Thank you, sir. I'm going to share the presentation. Then I will start my presentation. Just a moment, please.
No problem.
Excuse me, do you have my presentation, sir?
Yes, I can see your presentation and also
what about the files? Let me okay. Thank you, Kaimi sir.
Sure. Go ahead.
Good evening everybody. I just picked up a small portion of business strategy, which is the market segmentation. I prepared a brief presentation and will present it to you all. Hope it's okay. My presentation will need 5 to 10 minutes, and I will be going very briefly and shortly to each part. In this presentation, we will see what is market. Then what is market segmentation, about the definition of these two elements, market segmentation characteristics, basis for market segmentation, and at the end, how to do market segmentation. What is market? Generally, we can say market is people. For the people, we do not call anywhere or any place as a market. But, which kind of people? We cannot say market to any kind of people. We can say the people as a market that they have to have willingness to buy, purchasing power, or having money on hand or and cash on hand. Also, authority to buy. And here's a definition about the market. What is market? Market is a setup where two or more parties engage in exchange of goods, services, and information. Ideally, market is a place where two or more parties are involved in buying and selling. The core element of market is buying and selling goods or things, which can be tangible or intangible goods. It's too difficult to create or to produce a product that will satisfy everybody. That is why we focus on a segment of the total market. We cannot produce one product or one thing or good that will satisfy and that could be chosen by everybody in a small, even in a small portion of the people. That if we go through the segmentation of a market, a specific market, then we will be able to produce such kind of goods that can cover our own segment. What is market segmentation? As I told you before, grouping people according to their similarity, related to a particular product category. In this picture, you can easily find it that we divided these this collection of people, this population of people into three groups or into three segments. It is called by the market segmentation in business strategy and also in marketing management. What is the main characteristics of market segmentation? Our market segmentation should be and should have or should be on the following factors: age, gender, geographic location, income, spending patterns, cultural backgrounds, demographics, marital states, education, language, also mobility. Basis for market segmentation could be commonly divided into four parts, which first and second is also categorized under the descriptive basis, and the third and fourth it could be divided or classified into behavioral under the behavioral title. The first one is geographic location, also demographic, psychographic, also according to the benefits. This chart briefly tells us, according to the each basis for market segmentation. In demographic segmentation, we must focus on gender, age, family life cycle, race or ethnic group, education, income, occupation, family size, religion, home ownership, also some cultural. In geographic segmentation, we should focus on country, region, urban, suburban or rural places, population density, city size, also climate or weather. Psychographic segmentation, we should focus on lifestyle and also psychological variables, which is the personality or self-image. Benefit segmentation, we should focus on expected benefits from product use, which every customer has in its, their own minds. How to do market segmentation? First, we should identify the target market, then identify expectations of the target audience, then create subgroups, then review the needs of target audience, review the behaviors, then we should have name on our market segment. Also determine the size of target market. Finally, we should have made our marketing strategies based on the findings that we found from market segmentation. Finally, we will have such kind of markets. It's a picture taken from one of the markets in Bangkok, and I think it is the all the electrical equipment sold here inside this market. This was all my presentation. Thank you for your patience. Any question, I'm at your service.
Thank you so much, Mr. Ghaffari. Let's see if there's anyone has any questions. Sure, absolutely. So let me ask you a question. On the slide, you were talking about geographic and different bases of the market. You can go to that slide. Yeah, right here.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes.
So, which one of these four descriptive behavioral, I mean, on the two sides, which one do you think is the most important one? Is anyone the most important, or they're all with similar importance? So, or it all depends on the type of market and industry?
Actually, I think all of them are very important to be regarded during the market segmentation, but I think the demographic segmentation should be mainly regarded during the production of any kind of goods or services which could be provided by a company. For example, gender is very important. We cannot make the same thing, for example, the same clothes for the male and female section of the community. Also, the age is very important. You cannot consider both the child and an adult person. Their needs, their thoughts, and their own wishes are very different for regarding to our product. So the demographic segmentation should be mainly focused than the other segmentations.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you.
You're welcome. You're welcome. Okay.
Does anyone have any questions? Okay. Thanks much.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, who's going to be the next presenter? If you're ready, I mean, it's best if you can present now. Mr. Jalapiñar. Okay, who's going to be the next presenter? Who's the next volunteer? Who's the next volunteer? Okay. Very good. Okay, there you go. If you go onto the page Quick Start, you can click on the arrow beside Share File and then either share your desktop or at the very bottom, the second one. Yes, you got it. Perfect.
Hello, sir. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
First of all, thank you very much for giving me your time to talk in front of all of you and my classmates. My name is Riyadullah, and basically I'm an electrical engineer and working, before I was working with MTN Afghanistan, it's a telecom company operating in Afghanistan. So I have 4 years experience with them, but now I'm working with MTN Afghanistan, the managed service team. One of their engineers, telecom engineer. So I will just short discuss about MTN Afghanistan. When they started their, they launched their company in here, Afghanistan, and now they become the number one telecom business in Afghanistan. So first of all, I will short explain about their strategy and about their competitive moves, how they become number one in Afghanistan. So first of all, when they started, they give a strong mobile signal and coverage. And they use the technology which was Ericsson technology, and let me tell you that this Ericsson technology is the number one technology in the telecom sectors. So when they attract and see the customers through this strong mobile signal and the coverage of the areas everywhere, when they put the BTS, are you hearing me, sir?
Yeah, I can hear you, but the slide you're showing is only a yellow page. We don't see any slide.
In this slide, it's this it's in red color, and inside red color I put in a white color for it. Let me change it. I don't know why it's not appearing. From where can sir I pass and then start. Let me share my desktop. I already
your desktop was shared, but I was only viewing a yellow page. No, there was nothing shown on that page. I was able to see that you went to your folder.
Yellow page?
It was the background was yellow. So when you opened it up, it was just a yellow background, like nothing. Now I can see you are in your documents library.
Let me remove it, sir. background, sir. Let me review this. It's in the, let me tell you, documents, there's a strategy management and MT and Afghanistan strategy. You can open this.
No, we don't, we are not
able. Can you check the library documents?
Oh, now
and from there, WWS.
Yeah, you opened it. I could see it right now.
Sir, you can see.
Now I was able to see.
Okay.
Yes.
Let me start it again. First of all, I will tell about the MT in Afghanistan. Okay, about its strategy and it's about its competitive advantage, how they sustain their competitive advantage by becoming number one, remain the number one company still from last from 2000 to becoming number one, and its subscribers are more than 4 million. It's got 4 million subscribers here in Afghanistan. So first of all, when they started their strategy, and I tell you that the strategy, it has a competitive mode, and how you can become a number one leader in your market. So they use their strong technology, which was Ericsson based in telecom sector. We have several kinds of technology. For example, Ericsson, Motorola, NSN, and Huawei, ZTE, Alcatel. These are the vendors which are giving the tools to these operators. Operators, I mean the company which are going to launch their services, mobile service in any of the country. So MTN is basically a South African company, and it has more than 21 branches in all over the world. So starting from South Africa, like in Afghanistan, in Iran, and I think in Kuwait, and the rest of the African countries, it has their branches. So first, when they start their work here in Afghanistan, 2006, they start their operations. So they use the as I told you, how they attract and please the customer. They attract and please the customer through a strong coverage. Their best station centers where they co-located, they implement the sites which use the technology of Ericsson, and it has strong coverage. So everyone was able to receive the signal on mobile and then to start its activity. So how they, the second one, how they compete successfully. They, first of all, when they launch here in Kabul, they have just one base station. I mean the base station is the center where your main every of the all of the customer which are using. So they have their like, for example, their registries services here in this station. So you have your all of your home location registration, your washroom location registration, I mean the data which the customer subscriber has, its name, its about its everything which when they are talking about to each other, everything is going and recording in the base station. So first of all, they started from one base station here in Kabul, and now in all of Afghanistan they have more than 14 base stations. I mean in Kabul they have one base station in Kunduz, in Mazar, in Tahar, in Jalalabad, in Herat, and so on, in other provinces they have their base station. So they compete successfully. And how they grow their business? First of all, when they, as I told you, they started from Kabul, and now in all Afghanistan they have their services, exception the one province which is named in Nuristan, and this due to the security problems, it's located with the border with Pakistan. And as you know, there is a lot of security issues from Taliban, and they have covered the area Taliban, so they cannot give their services to that province. So, and then about their operations, how they achieve their target objectives, and how they conduct operations. So they started their survey of sites from one from the one province, I mean from Kabul. They put one site which successfully they have launched their services, and then they have started to survey another sites in Kabul and rest of the provinces, and they have taken engineers which went to site surveys in all of the provinces, and they have transferred their service from Kabul to rest of the provinces. So they were successful in their operations. And their MTN became successful, and till now they have the number one position in the market. And now I will shortly tell about how they sustain their competitive advantage. And they compete successfully, and till now from the 2007 they are remain number one company, and no other operator We have a lot of operators like Roshan, AWCC, and Etisalat, which are launched here also. They did not take on the competitive position from this company. It has the competitive advantages because it has more than, as I described, that it has more than 4 million subscribers here in Afghanistan. So no other operator has a size of this, like this number of customers. So they have the seasonal number of buyers. I mean subscribers, the person who is using this coverage of mobile. So I can refer here as a buyer. So it has competitive advantages because a lot of people use SIM cards of MTN and they have used and it has a strong coverage, so it's remain number one. And why I will tell you about that, why this is number this sustainable advantages which is have is because of these four strategic approaches and being the industry lower cost provider. So when they started their coverage here in Afghanistan, before MTN we have AWCC and Roshan, and they have cost the subscribers, the people which are using by minutes. So if you talk 5 seconds or 10 seconds, they have charged you per minute. For example, the per minute call was 5 Afghani at that time. So I think 5.5 Afghani was the price. But when MTN launched their services, they have charged subscribers per second. So if you talk less than 10 seconds, 5 seconds or 4 seconds, you are just charged for 10 seconds, no more than 10 seconds. So that's why they are the lowest cost provider in the industry. And their differentiated features was this because they are charging per second. Other operators, they have charged per minute. If you talk 5 seconds or 10 seconds, they have deduct from you 5.5 Afghani from your mobile. But MTN was the only operator which charge subscriber per second. If you talk more less than 10 seconds, you are just getting, for example, if you divide 5.6 Afghani to 60 seconds, so I think just less than one Afghani was the cost for that subscriber. And about NOR initiatives, this was the need for each subscriber because everyone wants to talk from our operator, which cost them per second because they have not talked fully minute. They have just talked, for example, 20 seconds or 15 seconds, but the operator which they were using before MTN, they were charging them per minute. So the NOR initiatives or MTN maintained, it has successfully covered this NOR initiatives also from the people. And about expertise and resource strength that Railway cannot compete or imitate, I mean the quality of service. And I told you before, if you go and search in the internet, this Ericsson technology, it's European technology. And more than 60% companies of the world is using this because it has a good quality of service. Its voice is very clear. When you are talking, you are making the calls, so you can hear one each very clearly. But for example, the rest of the companies in Etisalat are using Huawei tools, which is Chinese. So their quality is not too clear they are using. And about the business model, you know that their business model, but the stuff that a company which is starting their business, that should give benefit both for company and for the person who is using this from this company, any subscribers. They when they use their SIM card of MTN, they charge per second, so they have the advantage because they were charged less compared to the other operators. And MTN has a economic benefit because lot of subscribers they use the SIM card of MTN. So in first 2 years they have covered all of the expenses which they were done. Now MTN is getting more money because it has more than 1200 sites which are in all of Afghanistan. So now they are in the benefits. So thank you sir for giving me the time. It was just short discussion about my presentation that I prepared for MTN Afghanistan. So thanks a lot. If anybody has any questions, so I'm here.
Thank you very much. Does anyone have any questions? Yeah, first of all, I want to commend you. Very good job, because yours was very much to the point regarding your own job and your own company, and you applied a very nice business model. Perfect. Very good. Very good job. So, just a quick question for you.
Yeah.
So what do you think will make your company stand out when you're using a business model, when you're applying everything, when you're out competing everyone? What is the, if you want to single out one strategy that makes you look better? I mean, you can do lower costs, you can do on focus on your clients, that's great. But how do you basically implement that, like in nutshell?
Yeah, so basically you need to give a service to the people which they use, they clearly use this, and quality of service is very important. So MTN has provided the quality of service. It was their objective to take the position, the number one position in the market. And they have used the tools which were number one, so they have benefits from all of the things which they use. So the quality of service was very good. That's why the people used, and the company has also received a good benefit from their investment here in Afghanistan.
Very good presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot.
Okay, so who's going to be the next presenter? Who's the next volunteer? Okay. Who's going next? Who is the next presenter? Okay, please understand that these presentations are part of your final score. So those of you who do not present, you will not get that score. So what I will tell you is that next session will continue with these presentations. In the meantime, let me just show you your project. Your final project that I also emailed you this evening earlier is that you write an essay, executive summary on what you learned during the course and how you're going to apply it to your career. So it's going to be like, it could be not more than 10 pages, minimum 8 pages. You need to use practical and real applications, and imaginary or fake data is not acceptable. So I would like for you to give me examples of your own career. A good example is for Mr. Riazullah, like you tell me exactly how you implement that in your class. This is going to be due in 3 weeks from now. So next week you have, and then 2 weeks on top of that. So 3 weeks from now, I should receive that. So let me tell you the exact date. I would expect that by maybe less than 3 weeks, because it needs to be submitted by end of April. So April 30th. So I need that by April 30th, which is a Tuesday. April 30th, which is a Tuesday. Okay, so that would be April 30th, which is a Tuesday. Okay. So that's for yes, that's for your final project. So is there anybody else left who wants to? Yes, I just showed you the. It's right in front of you. It's you will give me. You will write an executive summary on how you will basically use what you learned during your business strategy. So you basically are telling me in your essay that what, I mean, those topics that we discussed, like outsourcing, value chain, whatever we discussed, how you're going to use basically business strategy in your own job, in your own career. Okay, yes, so we have another presenter, Mr. Kakar. Yes, for sure. Let's. Yes, I will have Mr. Kakar present. So that's for. For your assignment, let me find the show. Okay. Yes, please go ahead, Mr. Kakar. You can go ahead onto Quick Start, click on the share file, and either share your desktop or browse your file from your computer and just upload it onto our page. Okay. Okay, perfect. But I can't hear you. I can see your slides, but I can't hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, yes, I can hear you now.
Okay, with your permission, sir, and permission of my classmates. Unfortunately, I was not ready, but I couldn't make it during the class time to just put a few slides together and participate and can have better presentation next time. But I would like to talk about the strategic planning. As we learned during our business strategy classes, that strategic planning is very important, and it is the process of defining a company or an organization strategy, its direction, and guide that company on how to use and allocate its resources to pursue this strategy that they are putting together. Generally, on this strategic planning deals with a number of things, and it always give us a response to one of the key questions that I listed there, that what do we do, that company, for whom do we do it or work for, how do we excel our activities. And this really helps an organization or a company in determining where it goes over the new the next 2, 3, 4 or long term period that they are going to work in this sector. And a key component are the vision, which we all understand that that is actually the outline that a company wants to be there, and the mission that is I can define that as a steers to reach our vision or steps that we take toward achieving our long term our vision, and then we are having one of the components, which is value, and values could be defined that they are the beliefs that are shared among the stakeholders of a company in or an organization, including the knowledge and skills that organization contains. And then I was going to write strategy, so I wrote whatever I wrote. This helps to ensure that we are going to the right or we are going toward the right direction, or this company is going to toward the right direction. I also added a slide about the business analysis techniques that a company will look at, plus some other techniques that they analysis techniques that they will use. Two of them, which are very common, and we took them also in our class. They were the SWOT. I left a T there, SWOT analysis and the PEST analysis. And we can see that in SWOT there are strengths and opportunities, which is helping, which is talking about the positive side of a company or the strong points of a company, and there are weaknesses and threats, which are talking about the harmful or the stuff that a company should be aware of so they can develop to better compete and better work in the sector that they are working. And also I added there the PEST analysis, which are political factors and economical factors and social factors that a company would need to look at for a better business strategy and a better strategic planning. I hope this was to contribute to my today's class.
Thank you, Mr. Kakar, for sharing your slides with us. So basically, could you give us an example how strategic planning is helping you and your own company as well? Like a practical example.
Definitely. I'm working in agriculture sector. And prior to the company that I the project that I was working on now, I worked on developing farm service centers, we call it. We call it a one-stop shop, which is providing all agriculture inputs and supplies to the farmers. So we develop for them a number of strategic planning which help these farm service centers to understand their what they are providing to the farmers, how they are going to help the farmers with what they provide, and how can they enhance their input market and their technical assistance market to within the region that they are working in and extended to a new region. Every one-stop shop had a vision, which was clearly outlining what they are going to provide to their farmers and to the producers. They are working in agriculture sectors. They had a number of I can say values within every farm service centers, including technical staff there, skilled employees there, and a training hall which was helping them to provide technical assistance to the farmers, which other companies couldn't provide that within the country. And they had a number of other plans and strategies, marketing plan, and market assessments, and others, which were helping them in better implementation and of their strategy and field.
Beautiful, very good. Thank you so much. So this will end our like today's class. Basically, we'll leave it here, and we'll continue next session with the next presenters. Whoever is going to present, and please keep in mind again that those of you who do not present, you will be losing this score for your individual presentation. Mr. Shakur, would you want to do a last presentation?
Good evening, professor and dear classmates. Actually, I'm not ready for today's presentation, but I have a question which is not clear yet. Actually, you gave us the final individual assignment, and it has been written about its due date, which is September 23rd.
Oh, no, no, no. Oh,
and you...
Yeah, that's a mistake there. Let me... yeah, it's April 30th, yeah. That's a mistake there.
Okay. That will be April 30th, and the individual presentation will be, we will have the next sessions a chance to present our presentation. Am I right?
Yes, yes, correct. Thanks for,
thank you.
For mentioning that. Yes, I'll fix that. And, yeah, it's April 30th.
Excuse me, sir.
Sure, go ahead.
Sir, we got our individual assignments. This is our final project assignment. Like we don't, we will not be, we will not do any group project.
Yes, yes. You only have personal presentation, and you have this final individual project. So you would not have a any group project. That's correct.
Sir, can we send our projects prior to due date for rechecking or for any suggestions from your side?
Absolutely. You can absolutely do that, yes.
Thank you, sir.
Sure, you're welcome. So, yes, it's April 30th. Okay, I'm going to email you this April 30th correction. So thank you, everyone. So those of you who did not get a chance to present today and were not ready, you have the next session as your last chance to present. And then you have 3 weeks from now, almost, until April 30th for your final project. Are there any questions? Yeah, it's 2 weeks and a little bit, like 2 weeks and a half. Okay, so thank you. All the best to all of you, and have a nice week.